Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in. I'm Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're going to continue talking about what happens when you put ground pour near microstrips or near strip lines. Now, in a previous video, what we looked at is what happens when you bring ground pour near an impedance control trace, either a microstrip or a strip line on an internal layer. What we saw was you can actually bring it closer than what the typical PCB design guideline, the 3W rule, tells you the limit should be. If you bring it in too close, you start to modify the impedance. So there's one other aspect that has been looked at by other authors in the literature and in the industry, but that hasn't been talked about here on this channel. And so we're going to talk about it today, and that is losses. How does this affect losses in your traces? Let's go ahead and get started. So in the previous video, we looked at what happens when we have a situation like this, where we have an impedance controlled trace, okay? And impedance controlled trace above some ground plane, and then we have some nearby copper pour. There are some arguments for and against pouring copper all over the surface layers around your routing. The impedance deviation is one of those arguments. And what we actually found in the previous video, link in the description, is that the capacitance between these traces and the mutual inductance between the ground pour and the actual trace, but mostly the capacitance, will affect the impedance, characteristic impedance of this trace. So when this spacing is large, we get microstrip behavior. When it's small, we get coplanar waveguide behavior. And eventually what happens is you're adding in some capacitance, and this capacitance reduces the characteristic impedance of this trace. Now, when we have our traces on the surface layer and we have some copper pour nearby, what happens is the fields from the trace are actually terminating over here in our grounded copper. What this is doing is it's actually causing the current density to bunch up along the edge of this trace. So essentially what's happening is the current density around the edge of the trace is being modified by the flux, or the electric flux around the trace, the field flux. What that does is it actually changes the skin resistance. So we've talked before about losses in impedance controlled routing and losses on transmission lines. So one of the loss mechanisms that actually happens on a transmission line is the skin effect. And the skin effect just refers to this effect where when we have a AC signal propagating on a conductor, some of that current tends to bunch up along the edges of the conductor. Now, when we have some nearby copper pour and it's grounded, what happens is the electric field distribution around the trace is also modified, okay? So instead of having these lines that come out kind of radially, we have some lines that actually start to terminate at the nearby grounded copper pour. And so that modifies the current density distribution inside the trace, that then modifies the skin resistance. And so this is where the question comes up of, how does this arrangement of bringing my copper pour closer to my microstrips or to my strip lines, if this were an internal layer, start to affect losses? This is something that's actually been looked at by a few people in the industry. One of the recent articles in an industry publication looked at this from a simulation standpoint. There's another very well-known person in the industry named John Coonrod. He works over at Rogers. He's actually looked at a comparison between the case of where we have just a microstrip, so basically any copper pour is really far away, and then a coplanar line. So where we have the microstrip and then we have some grounded copper brought in close to this line, and we essentially create a coplanar waveguide. And this skin effect is the primary mechanism that's going to be responsible for the effect on losses, because again, we have this current crowding around the edge of the trace. However, it's more than just the skin effect. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna look at some of those results and then see what actually happens in real boards. So what we wanna look at now is a recent article from Design 007. So this is a really great industry publication, and if you wanna keep up with new developments that are going on in the electronics industry and with PCBs in general, definitely suggest you subscribe to it. What we're gonna do is we'll look at this article first. So this article that I'm showing on screen right now looks specifically at the impact of copper pour near a impedance controlled line like a microstrip or a strip line and how that affects both loss and impedance. So this guy, Chang Fei Yi from Keysight Technologies, he looked at specifically how the losses and impedance are affected in simulation. This is the April 2019 article, and we'll actually link to this article as well in the description. But if you open up this article and you scroll down to his results, what you'll actually see is, first, you'll see something consistent with the field solver results that I showed in the previous video. So he looked at some different cases where he's actually testing the 3W rule, kind of like the test of the 3W rule that I showed in the previous video. Here in this portion of the video I'm highlighting in blue, you can see the test cases that he looks at, and he's basically going from 1W all the way to 8W in terms of the spacing between the trace and then the nearby copper pour. So as the copper pour gets closer to the trace, in this simulated TDR measurement with this case 1A, you do actually see the impedance start to decrease, which is actually what you would expect. You know, remember, when you bring in the ground pour near the trace, that parasitic capacitance starts to dominate, and it dominates over any mutual inductance that might exist between the ground pour and the trace. And so because of that, you see the impedance start to go down when you bring the ground pour in closer. He's only seen in this simulation a drop of 1 ohm, so not huge drop when he's at a 1W spacing. Look at what happens here with the insertion loss in this graph here on the right. So in this graph, we actually see a really big dip in the insertion loss, especially once we get out beyond 10 gigahertz. You might be thinking, well, you know, 10 gigahertz, that's really super high speed, and, you know, he's going all the way out to 20 gigahertz here, but, you know, USB 3.0, even lower generations of DDR, becoming more common in a lot of embedded systems, definitely the frequency range you want to care about, even here on the lower end of the graph. So here, even when we're at, like, you know, right here, 4, we start to see a loss increase, so greater losses, once we bring the ground pour in too close to the line. Even here when we're at 2W, okay, so case 1B, let me just scroll up here. So case 1B is 2W, and then here in this blue curve, you can see you still start to get a loss increase. So really it's up to you to judge whether or not the additional loss that you might see in this arrangement is gonna be appropriate for your trace length. So the trace length is really what's gonna be affected. Do you have to shorten your trace in order to accommodate that additional loss? So that's something that you as the designer have to figure out. And you know, we'll talk more about that as we keep talking about stuff with transmission lines and routing and designing traces and all of this. He also looked at differential impedance. So same simulations, and you see basically the same results. You know, you're essentially getting loss on each side of the differential pair. Assuming that they're affected equally on each side of the differential pair, then you would naturally expect to see the signal read out at the receiver to be smaller. This is kind of the magic question here, because as I read through this originally, I didn't see any mention of plating. Okay, so the plating is actually really important, and the plating, as pointed out by John Coonrod in one of his videos with Judy Warner, who does the on-track podcast for Altium, he actually points out some of the pros and cons of Enig plating. So Enig is electroless nickel immersion gold, okay, and that plating can actually produce some losses along the edge of the trace, essentially increasing the skin effect along that edge of the trace. And so he actually showed some experimental results for this. You can go into the description and you'll find a link to that podcast with John Coonrod. I highly recommend you watch it, because John, super knowledgeable guy, especially about all things high speed and RF. And he always has a lot of interesting stuff to say about this topic, especially when it comes to materials. So definitely a guy you want to go and learn from. Also, we're going to link to one of his YouTube videos where he explains the experimental results that I'm going to show right now. So these experimental results, actually this is an image of the plating along the trace, but the experimental results for this type of arrangement where you have this plating along the trace, those are what John Coonrod looked at. And so here in this graph, you can see we're comparing a microstrip with a grounded coplanar waveguide, okay? So grounded coplanar waveguide, essentially just the coplanar waveguide arrangement where we bring the copper pour in very close to the trace And then we line it with vias, okay? And that's done for mode selection. It's also done for some level of isolation. But what he's done here is he's actually shown something really interesting. When we have bare copper and just the microstrip, we see the same level of losses as we would with a coplanar waveguide. So this actually seems to go counter to the results that were just shown in that article from simulation. And so I think this is really nice because it really does illustrate the importance of the plating that you put on your bare copper. So normally during fabrication, as I'm sure most of you are aware, you know, comes off the line, they do a plating. Plating is used for protection, but it also influences losses. So if you're going to be working at like 80 gigahertz here, what you'll notice in the case of putting a Enig plating on is you actually see a big increase in losses. So this is an increase of a little more than half a decibel per inch. And if you go over here to this other graph and do this comparison for the same plating thickness, it's an even greater increase. So this illustrates two things. One, the plating type is important. And then two, as you bring in the ground pour closer and you get into the grounded coplanar arrangement, that actually increases the losses because it increases the current density going through the plating along the edge of the trace. And you can actually see where that would occur. It would be along here along the side where I'm showing with my mouse. Working at these frequencies, normally what you would do is you would use something aside from Enig. So Enig is fine when you're doing, you know, low speed or even like sub 1 gigahertz radio. Totally fine with Enig, you know, SPI bus or I2C, those digital protocols, totally fine. When you're going into RF and let's say you want to work at even Wi-Fi frequencies. So here where I've got my cursor right here with these two types of traces, let's say you were going to do Wi-Fi. Well, here you can see you actually get a big increase in losses in dB per inch going from bare copper to plated with Enig, even at, you know, 5.8 gigahertz Wi-Fi. That's not super high frequency by any means. I mean, you know, you probably, if you're watching this right now, you're probably using a smartphone or you're using a laptop and it's using a Wi-Fi connection to watch this video. So it's not like that's an uncommon thing. So that is one instance where you might want to consider an alternative plating to Enig due to the losses that it creates. Okay. Once you get out here into like the 70 something gigahertz, so like the radar modules that my company's done, once you're in 77 gigahertz, go with immersion silver, definitely low loss. You've already got enough losses to deal with just from the copper roughness itself and then the dielectric losses. Go with immersion silver to, you know, keep the losses from increasing further. Hopefully this shows the importance of the plating that you use on your traces, okay? The plating does have an effect on losses. It's not like it just acts the same as copper. There is some interface between the plating and the copper. That interface can be rough and that can create additional losses due to copper roughness. So the copper is already going to be rough, but when you add in plating, it can get even more rough, and that increases your losses a little bit. If you like this video, hit that like button, hit the subscribe button, go check out the links in the description, download that free trial of Altium Designer and try out the routing tools, and don't forget to call your fabricator.